Well, hey, you guys, welcome to Seacoast Online and happy Easter.
Yes.
I'm so glad to be with you this weekend to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus. I'm Pastor Ryan. Hopefully many of you are joining us for the first time. We just want to welcome you. This is my beautiful bride, Shannon.
Happy Easter. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. So from our family to yours, a wonderful happy Easter. And we've got a great service in store for you. But Shannon, tell me, what does Easter mean to you?
You know, you guys have probably heard me say before, Easter is my favorite adult holiday because
right.
I just love this entire weekend. I love the sacrifice of Good Friday that
yeah.
Jesus did for us that just moved into the rejoicing redemption
yes.
of him coming out with our freedom in hand
That's
on
right.
Resurrection Sunday.
That's right. I love
so,
it.
So it's
good.
Amazing.
Well, like I said, we've got an amazing service in store for you. And I don't know what situation you might be in your life, wherever you're watching from. Maybe there's an area of your life that you just feel like you need new life to be breathed into that. And I want you to know that Jesus is available to do that for you right now. I don't know if it's finances, your career, your hopes and dreams. Maybe there's
right.
a relationship, a loved one whose health is kind of struggling right now. Whatever it might be, Jesus wants to meet your needs this morning. So we hope
right.
more than anything that you encounter the living Savior today
Absolutely.
As we worship together. So let's ask God to bless our time together as we worship. Father, thank you so much for your presence that is with us wherever we are. Lord, we pray that in this service that we hear from your voice, you speak through Pastor Josh's message and meet whatever those needs are, wherever we may be watching. God, thank you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, hey, we've got a minute or so before we're going to kick off the service. I want to encourage you to grab our mobile app, the Seacoast mobile app, and get ready to take notes on this message from Pastor Josh.
Yes.
And we'll join the rest of the campuses here in just a minute.
This is the word here in the flesh, living among the meek and lowly. The voice of God, his every breath, salvation.
Good morning. Happy Easter. Welcome to Seacoast Church. So glad that you're here today. Could you grab the hand of the person next to you? I promise they're clean. They don't look any better than that. But could we take a moment to pray? Father, we thank you so much for your love that gave up everything for us. We thank you, Lord God, that you knew exactly what you were dying on a cross for. And as you hung on the cross, you thought of us. We thank you, Lord God, that you paid the price for sin that we never could have paid, even though we are guilty of it. We thank you, Lord God, that it doesn't matter what any person in this room is struggling with. You are a God that can overcome. You can are a God that can intercede. You are a God that wants to lift up our eyes and say, man, you came so that we may have life and have it to the full. So bless us today as we celebrate you and the gift of the empty tomb. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. And everybody said, I'm going to say he is risen. You say he is risen indeed. He is risen. You sound good. Let's try it again. He is risen. So glad that you're here. Can we give it up for everyone who's here for the first time? So glad that you're here. Everyone who's tuning in online, we're so honored that you came and worshiped with us today. On your way in, everyone was given this card here and in our overflow. Please take a moment to fill it out. If you didn't get a card, you can text the word survey to 32320. We'd love to learn a little bit more about you, but before we do anything else, would you take a moment to greet your neighbor and tell him, he is risen.
I love being outside, very adventurous, used to work in law enforcement, just grew up pretty tough. I was just pruning this bush, and I was even wearing gloves, and just a little prick happened on, like, in my joint. The next day I woke up and my hand was really swollen, and so I just went to urgent care. They found out it was a really serious, slow-growing bacteria that is generally in your lungs, but it had gone into my bones. It's just really hard to treat and really hard to track. I didn't know who to tell, because it's just, again, in my mind, it's a thorn. Like, this is still not a big deal. At that point, I felt so isolated. And so I decided I was gonna tell pretty much everybody. Anything that life throws at you, I want people in my corner helping me go through it. I think we all have thorns. Like, there's something that we might think is not big, but it is. And it's something that we need support on. And it's something that can fester if we don't wave our flag and, you know, bring it to the Lord's feet and, you know, to our community.
A letter to my children. I'm not sure where to start on this. Well, I guess I'll just write. I don't mean to sound sad, but with all that has been going on lately with my health, I would just feel better if I could put these words down on paper for you. First of all, I just want you both of you to know how very much I love you. God has blessed me so very much by allowing me to be your mother. I know we've had some really tough years with my health, and I haven't been able to really spoil you like I would have liked. I'm sorry if you end up reading this letter because it means that the Lord has called me home. I pray that you always stay close to the Lord, that you always pray for wisdom in the decisions of your life. I've already been praying for years now for your future wives, and I know that God has someone really special for each of you. And please know that your father is a strong Christian man, and he'll be following God's plans for him. I'm very proud of my three guys, and I'll be waiting for you all in heaven. Smile and enjoy your lives. You've made me so very happy. And I love you all very, very much. God bless you. love mom. So that's a letter that was written for 14-year-old Adam. I didn't know it existed until after my mom passed when I was around 38. She ended up having to have open heart surgery, her first of two, and she was due for her third right before she passed. And not knowing if she was gonna come out on the other side, she wrote a letter to my brother and I of things that she wanted us to know and to be able to remember and prayers she had for us. She would always point to her faith in God and just trusting that he had wisdom in whatever was gonna happen.
My desire to have a family has always been there. Mac and I got married. Couple years into our married life, I found out I was pregnant. And at that moment, we were ecstatic. But unfortunately, that pregnancy ended in a miscarriage. Every time we would go through such deep disappointments, I would lay myself before the Lord. I would pour out my heart. I'll never forget specifically one night I went on a walk and just the overwhelming disappointment, sadness came over me because I wanted to be a mom so bad. And I prayed specifically. I said, God, if I am not going to be a mom, you have got to take this desire away from me. And one of the times that I was pouring my heart out to the Lord, I heard him say, Cindy, I designed you with this incredible desire to mother, and I will fulfill that desire. I made you that way. And then God was so good and allowed us to get pregnant and carry the baby to full term, and that was Brandon.
I shouldn't be alive. My future was 6 feet under, 1 foot in the grave, no hope to be saved. No, I shouldn't be alive. But I'm a miracle child, defied every diagnosis. And as close as it came, I can stand here and say, I'm a miracle child. Death, where is your sting? My Savior's word is mine. I am resurrected, blood protected. I am a miracle child. If you're facing the odds, if you think you're beyond His saving, there's no life He can't raise. No, your wounds aren't too great. He's a miracle God.
Yeah.
will try.
Treatment-wise, we're seeing if it's dormant or dead. We're going to claim it's dead. It's no longer there. I am definitely the strongest that I've been because of the thorn. Again, I would define myself as pretty strong before, but I was using my own strength. Once I brought everything out to the open with the situation, the community was able to rally around me and my family. He sent them specifically for us. We were not alone during the situation, and Jesus was always there.
My mom had a legacy of faith that she passed down through our family, and it was because of that faith that I ended up accepting Christ. It's still been incredibly hard day to day, and there are still days that I'm in a zone of sadness and pain, and the littlest things can trigger it. But if I can be half the example to my children about what it means to lean on Christ and to live in that day-to-day faith in struggles when it doesn't make sense, then I know my kids are gonna have an amazing example of what it means to have a godly father, a godly parent, because of the example that my mom set.
You know, the Israelites were promised for their king to come. And it was years and years later, but Jesus fulfilled that promise. And just like my story, from the very beginning, I had this incredible desire to be a mom. And there were many years of incredible disappointments, and we had to go through three more miscarriages. But yet, God spoke to me over and over again in my spirit that you trust me. And sure enough, I was able to watch God miraculously provide us with three miracle children. God performed a miracle and gave us the promise that he had placed in my heart years and years before.
Well, good morning. Hey, is anybody grateful that we serve a God of miracles? The greatest miracle of which was that he came out of the grave. There is a tomb that is still empty to this day, and that's why we gather today to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. We're glad you're here. If you're here in the room, if you're in an overflow room or at one of our campuses, if you're new to Seacoast, we are one church with 13 locations, as well as those of us online. I got to shout out our McClellanville campus. Are celebrating their 10-year anniversary this weekend. So we're grateful for you guys, and we're glad you're here. My name's Josh. If I haven't met you, I have the opportunity to serve as lead pastor here. So grateful for our church family, and I'm so grateful for a God of miracles. I loved the video that we watched where three different Seacoasters grabbed a chair and sat in it and shared the story of what God has done in their life. And I know that if we had time, it would be so amazing for each of us to sit in this chair. And I know that if we did that, some of you would say, man, I wanna tell you what God has done in my life. I wanna testify about his miracles and the way he's come through. And I also know that there are some of us that we're sitting in this chair and we're still waiting on a miracle. We're still waiting for God to show up in our life. We feel stuck in some form or fashion. And you know, Easter is the one time that all of our church family, just about all of us, come together and worship together. So what I thought I'd do is open it up to testimony time and just have you guys come in. We're gonna start over here and just share your story with us, how it's going. No, we won't do that. We got Easter egg hunts and stuff like that to do. But here's what I know. Here's what I know is that every one of you has a story. And we wanna do something different this Easter that we've never done before, which is I wanna hear your story. I want to know what God is doing in your life. And so you got a card when you came in. If you would pull that out for me, I would love for you to do that. If you didn't get a card, you can take out your phone and text the word survey to 320-320, and you can fill the card out online. And listen, I know even those of you that are guys here, you're like, I'm not filling out your stupid card. I need you to do it. We got a deal with Mark Zuckerberg. We're going to give you all of him, all your information, and it pays us really good money to do that. And so, just kidding. Don't even worry about it. If you don't want to put your name on it, you don't have to. It'd be helpful. But I really want to know what's on your heart. One of the questions on here is, I would like to hear messages on what the Bible says about blank. And we'd love to hear from you. In fact, we're going to do a series later in the year, taking some of the top answers that you give us and addressing what does God's word say about specific issues. You want to make sure we're speaking to the things that you're dealing with and wrestling with. But the most important part of it, if you don't give us your name, if you don't answer any of the questions, is the very last one. And it's really for you as much as it is for us. And there's a few boxes on the bottom of this card, and it says today, and the first one says, I'm not a follower of Jesus Christ. I'm not a follower of Jesus Christ. And if you would check that box, if that describes who you are, I would just say a couple things to you. One, I would say, I'm so glad that you're here, and I really mean that. I mean that because from the day we started this church 36 years ago, we had you in mind. And the reason we had you in mind is because God had you in mind when he sent his son to live a sinless life and to die on a cross and to raise from an empty tomb. And sometimes in church world, we can get so focused on people who are religious or who feel like they've got it all together, and we neglect the people that God's heart is very much serving, which is those that would say, hey, we're not there yet. And I would just encourage you that if you read the Easter story, you would find yourself in the story in several different places. One of them is at the very end of the crucifixion. In fact, when Jesus took his very last breath, there was a guy who was there. He was a Roman soldier, and we tend to vilify the Roman soldiers, but the reality is he was showing up to work that day. It was a pretty normal day for this guy. It just so happened that in the job that he had, there was a crucifixion on the calendar, and so he was doing what he was paid by the Roman government to do, and he was executing some criminals. And as Jesus breathed his very last, and this guy's standing here, all of a sudden darkness came over the entire land. An earthquake literally hit, shook the land, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. And in that moment, his eyes were opened, and he dropped to his knees and said, surely this is the Son of God. And my prayer for you is that you'll have a moment like he had. I pray it'll happen today. If not today, sometime in your journey, if you'll continue to come, you don't have to believe before you belong, but there will be a moment where you realize what Jesus said is true. And he was who he said he was. And if you're gonna start anywhere in terms of your questions, I would just encourage you, start with that. Like, did Jesus really raise from the dead? Is the thing that we're celebrating today, did it really happen historically? Start there. And if that answer, if you study that, and you'll find what many, many skeptics over the years have, as they've studied that answer, they found it to be true, it has to matter for all of us. I don't know about you, but I'm going with the guy who predicted his death and predicted his resurrection, and then he actually did it. I've been to a lot of funerals. I've never seen somebody get out of a coffin, but Jesus did. And so we're glad you're here if you check that box. You know, some of us would check the second box, and it says, I believe, but I'm stuck. I believe, but I'm stuck in pain, or I'm stuck in heartbreak, some area of our life. And that's what I want to spend the rest of our time talking about today, is those of us who are like, man, I believe, I've been around, I want to follow Christ, but I feel stuck. And we're going to look at three different people that Jesus came to. The resurrection is the biggest deal, but I would argue that it's pretty important to know who he came to after he raised from the dead. He had a limited amount of time that he was here in his resurrected body, and he chose strategically who to come to. Have you ever thought about who would you show up to if you were Jesus, if you raised from the dead? You guys remember when he was being crucified, there were these guys that were gambling on his clothes, you know, they were like casting lots. I think if I were Jesus, I would have shown up to their poker night and been like, oh, hey guys, deal me in here. I think those are my shoes. That'd be pretty fun. Or you remember Pilate, the guy that Pontius Pilate washed his hands of it. He was trying to play neutral. He was trying to act like he wasn't on either side. And if I were Jesus, I might show up to Pilate's house with a, you know, jar of soap. Just say, hey dude, surprise, I'm back. You know, who would you show up to? It's interesting to me that of all the people that he could have shown up to, Jesus showed up to some people who were stuck. Because there's power in the resurrection to get us from where we are to where we need to be, to where we want to be. Have you ever felt stuck in life? I saw a video the other day that really resonated with me. I want to show it to you real quick. You see, there's a sheep that gets stuck in this little crevice, and this good Samaritan guy, you know, wrapping this thing around his leg, and he pulls him out, right? This is freedom. I'm free. I know what it is to be free. Not anymore. I relate to that video. It's like God drags me out of a ditch and then I find myself in another ditch, right? Or the same ditch sometimes. And many of you may know what it feels like to be stuck, but just know that Jesus showed up to help those who were stuck. Three people that he showed up to. The first one that I want to point out to you is Mary. And Mary was stuck in heartbreak. She represents the heartbroken among us. And Mary's story is found in John chapter 20, verses 11 through 16. Here's what you need to know about Mary is that when Mary first met Jesus, she had spent all of her life being tormented by demons. Literally, she was that person in the family that nobody knew how to help. They tried everything they knew how to do, and she was just absolutely tormented by demons. And then she met Jesus, and he set her free, and her entire life was changed. She became a follower of Christ. She followed him all throughout his ministry, and now she's found herself in complete heartbreak because the very person who set her free, she had just watched die on a cross. And she was absolutely stuck in heartbreak. Here's what the story says. Mary was standing outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she stooped and looked in. She saw two white-robed angels, one sitting at the head and the other at the foot of the place where the body of Jesus had been lying. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" the angels asked her. "Because they've taken away my Lord," she replied. "And I don't know where they've put him." She turned to leave and she saw someone standing there. It was Jesus, but she didn't recognize him. "Dear woman, why are you crying?" Jesus asked her. "Who are you looking for?" She thought he was the gardener. "Sir," she said, "if you have taken him away, tell me where you put him and I'll go get him." And then he said a word that he had probably said many, many times. And I just imagine the intonation, the pronunciation had to resonate deep in her soul when Jesus said, "Mary, it's me." And everything changed for her. And I love the fact that of all of the people that Jesus could have shown up to first, it wasn't the king or the head of the church or the most important people. The very first person that Jesus showed up to in his resurrected body was a woman who was literally sobbing. She was stuck in heartbreak. And I know in a room of this size and at our campuses, there are many of us who can probably resonate with Mary. When's the last time that you wept? I'm not talking about crying. I'm talking about like ruin your makeup, or if you're dudes, whatever. I can't move forward. I can't think about anything else. My heart is so broken that I do not know where to go. Maybe you're grieving the loss of somebody. There was somebody here this Easter, just yesterday, whose mother died the day before completely unexpectedly, just absolutely stuck in heartbreak. Maybe you've had a relationship breakup and you thought this was gonna be the person. You put all of your eggs in that basket and it's over. And you don't know where to go. One thing I notice about Mary is that even though she was standing in the presence of Jesus, she couldn't see him because grief can do that to us. It can blind us. And you may feel like God is so far away from you. You may feel like he's left you, he's abandoned you. And I wanna encourage you, because of the resurrection, I can promise you that Jesus is a lot closer than you think. You just may not be able to see him through your grief. And he came back for you. God's word says that he draws near to the brokenhearted. He's always gonna find his way to heartbreak. And the resurrection gives us hope, not only that he can restore the pieces of our life and bring purpose out of our pain, but we also have hope for eternal life. That's why for believers, we grieve, but we don't grieve like people who don't have hope, because Jesus coming out of the grave was a promise, a fulfillment of the promise that God has planted eternity in all of our hearts. That's why death is so unnatural for us. That's why it's so painful. But he overcame death, he overcame the grave, and it gives us hope of eternal life if we'll surrender our lives to him and trust him for our salvation. So Jesus came to the brokenhearted. The second person that he showed up to was Thomas. And I know many of you are church people. Many of you may not be church people. You may be here for the first time, but you know Thomas's nickname. What did they call him? Doubting Thomas, right? Doubting Thomas. I think Thomas would be pretty ticked if we're gonna get to heaven, he's gonna be mad at us. Like, what, dude, it was one moment. Like, and he was pretty all in. Like a few chapters earlier, he was the one that when Jesus told the disciples that they were gonna kill him, that he was gonna die for them, he was like, well, have him kill me too, because I'm all in, I'm not going anywhere. He was a faith-filled man, but he found himself in this story stuck in his doubt. Jesus had shown up to a group of disciples and Thomas wasn't there. He took a really bad time to take a smoke break when the resurrected Christ came back. And I'll show you the story. It says that one of the 12 disciples, Thomas, nicknamed the twin, was not with the others when Jesus came. They told him, we have seen the Lord. But look at his reply. I won't believe it unless I see the nail wounds in his hands and put my fingers into them and place my hand into the wound in his side. Do you hear the doubt in him? I will not believe. This wasn't a maybe I'll believe. I won't believe. I'm done. I followed him for 3 years of my life. I've gone all in with him. I put everything into this and I watched him die on the cross. I'm not going there again. I can't do it. It's too hard. I'm not gonna believe. Have you ever been there? I don't believe. I can't do this again. Maybe you had opened up your heart to God in some season of your life, and maybe you were hurt by somebody who claimed to be a believer. Maybe you were even hurt by the church, and you're like, you know what? I'm not doing this anymore. I'm not going there. It's too painful. That's where Thomas was. I will not believe. I'm out. Y'all do this if you want to, but fool me once, shame on you, but fool me twice, shame on me. I'm not doing it. I'm not doing it. And so what does Jesus do? Shame on you, Thomas. I told you this was gonna happen. How could you have doubt? No, that wasn't Jesus's heart at all to Thomas. In fact, look what Jesus did. It says 8 days later, the disciples were together again, and this time Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, and I believe that is true of the room they were in, and it was definitely true of Thomas's heart at that moment. But suddenly, as before, Jesus was standing among them. I love that he just showed up, walked right through the walls. Feature of our resurrected bodies. This will be fun one day. We get to do that. And he says, peace be with you. And then he went to Thomas, and he said, hey, Thomas, put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hand into the wound in my side. Don't be faithless any longer. Believe. Of course, Thomas says, my Lord and my God. Then Jesus told him, you will believe because you've seen me. Blessed are those who believe without seeing me. That's you and I. There's an early adapter blessing for those of us that believe that didn't see him. But what I love about this is Thomas is so stuck in his doubt. The door is locked on his heart. I will not believe. And Jesus took every one of the steps that he needed to take to get to right where he was. He didn't shame him for his questions. He wasn't intimidated by his questions. And I want to encourage you, if you're dealing with doubt today, ask the questions. Because here's what I know, they will lead you to discover an empty tomb and a resurrected Christ. Jesus isn't intimidated by your questions. You need to see scars? Here you go, Thomas. But here's what I want you to notice is that he did ask Thomas to do something. He took every step to get to him, but then he said, Thomas, you need to reach out and touch him. Reach out your hands. And if you're stuck in doubt, I just want to encourage you, just reach out. God knows where you are. He knows how to get to you. He can walk through locked doors to get to you, but you're going to have to reach out and take a step. And when you do, I'm believing that you're going to discover that the power of the resurrection is going to have an impact on your doubts and that your doubt can turn to faith. So maybe you're here today and you're stuck in heartbreak. I'm praying that you'll experience hope because of the resurrection. If you're stuck in doubt, I'm praying that you'll experience faith today because of the resurrection. But one more person that he showed up to that I want to highlight is Peter. And Peter represents somebody who was stuck in failure. He was stuck in failure. Peter is one of my favorite people in the Bible. He is all in. He's the guy that when they came to arrest Jesus, he chopped a dude's ear off because he's like, let's go. You want to fight? We're going to fight, right? But the very last time that he saw Jesus was the moment of Peter's greatest failure and shame. Jesus was being led to the cross, and some people in the crowd came up to Peter and said, hey, you were with Jesus, weren't you? And he says, no, I wasn't with him. I don't know the guy. Three different times, he denies that he even knew Jesus in the moment that Jesus is dying for the sins of humanity. And the Bible gives us a window into that third time. It shows us this dramatic moment where Peter says, I did not know him. And then a rooster crows, which Jesus had predicted would happen. And then they lock eyes with each other. Can you imagine the failure that he felt? The shame that he had felt? That he had let Jesus down. He had walked away from him when he needed him most. And Jesus, in coming back out of the grave, he was like, I gotta get to Peter. I gotta find Peter. I've got to tell him and restore him from his failure. So the disciples did what we all do when we fail, especially when we fail in our relationship with Christ. Some of you have done that. You've tried to follow Jesus, but you've slipped up and you've fallen away. And we tend to go back to our life before Christ. He was fishing. That's what he was doing before Jesus had called him to a life of purpose. And Jesus goes out to the beach after a long night of the disciples fishing. And he's standing on the shore and he yells out to them and says, hey, how was fishing? They're like, not very good. And he says something that they would have definitely recognized because he also said it the first time he met them. Hey, why don't you throw your nets out on the other side of the boat? And in that moment, Peter realizes this is Jesus. And he dives off the boat because that's who Peter is, impulsive, all-in guy. And he swims to the shore. And Jesus had made breakfast for all of them, but he pulls Peter aside and he says, Peter, I need to talk to you. And there's exchange between Jesus and Peter that we miss in the English language because the Greek language, the language that the New Testament was written in, has four words for the word love where we only have one. And so in this exchange, Jesus asks Peter, he says, hey, Peter, do you love me more than these? And the word that he used for love is agape. It's unconditional, without limits, forever, no matter what. Do you love me? And Peter answers him and he says, yes, I love you, but he uses a different word. He uses the word phileo. And phileo is the root word we get Philadelphia, which is the city of what? Brotherly love. It's a lesser love. It's a friendship love. It's a brotherly love. And Peter basically says to Jesus, Jesus, you know, I can't do that. Like you saw me in my moment of failure. I can't get to agape, but I love you the best that I can. I love you with an imperfect love. And Jesus asks him again, do you agape me? And Peter begins to get emotional. He says, I don't. I phileo you. That's all I've got. I've fallen short. I've failed. I phileo you. And then one more time, Jesus asks him, but Jesus changes the word. Instead of asking him if he agapes him, he says, Peter, do you phileo me? And Peter says, you know I do. I phileo you. And he says, I want you to get on with your purpose in life. Go feed my sheep. I've got a plan for you. And here's what I love about that is Jesus says, Peter, I know you can't agape me, but I'm gonna meet you where you are. I'm gonna meet you at your imperfect, sometimes falls short, sometimes fails love. And because of my agape love for you, I can meet you at your phileo love and we can partner together and we can change the world. See, it's because God loved us first that we can even come to a place of saying, I love him. And some of you may feel like you've just failed in your relationship with God. You've walked away from him. You're not alone. You're in that resurrection story. And I would just encourage you to bring what you have. Recognize that the gospel is that we can't. Like we can't agape. We can't perfectly love Jesus, God, or anybody else. But we can surrender our heart to him and experience an agape love that loves us no matter what, that will forever change our life. And then we can go do as Peter did. He became one of the boldest leaders in the early church. We're standing here today on the shoulders of men like Peter who were imperfect and failed, but experienced the love of God. And we can do the same thing. See, I love that Jesus rose from the dead, but I also love that he made appearances to specific people. And he's still making appearances today. In fact, I believe he's here in the room. I believe that we've experienced his presence together as we've worshiped. And I love what he said in an appearance that he made to the disciple John. And he recorded it in the book of Revelation, chapter 3, verse 20. He said, "Look, I stand at the door and I knock. If you'll hear my voice and open the door, I will come in and correct you and rebuke you." And he says, "I'll come in and we'll share a meal together. I'm gonna love you. And in that love, it's gonna change your life." He's knocking on the doors. I believe he's knocking on every door in this room today. That every seat represents a heart that Jesus is just knocking. "Hey, let me in. Let me in." Where are you today in your walk with Christ? It's a question that I believe we all owe to ourselves to answer. Maybe you check that first box. I'm not there yet. Again, we're glad you're here. Maybe you feel stuck in some area of your life, but I believe that there are many people that are here today that are gonna check that third box, which says, "Today, I'm committing or recommitting my life to Christ. Today, I'm opening the door and saying, Jesus, I don't have all the theology figured out. I don't know what all this means, but I know that you came. You lived a sinless life and you took my sin on the cross willingly, went to the cross, took all my shame, heartbreak, failure, all of it. And you died for me. And you paid the eternal cost of our sin that all of us owe that we can't pay. He paid for it on the cross. And then he rose from the dead, promising us eternal life as well." And if you're here today and you would say, "You know what, I want to open my heart to Jesus, to the resurrected Christ, to share a meal with him, to get to know him, to experience his love," I want to encourage you to check that box. But I also want to pray for you. So would you bow your heads as we close our service, and we're going to pray together. And as you bow your heads, if you're here today and you're saying, "Hey, I want to give my life to Christ. I want to commit my life to Christ." Or maybe you're here and you said a prayer a long time ago, but your life, you need a fresh start. You need an encounter with the resurrected Christ. If that's you, I just want to pray for you. Would you slip your hand in the air? I'm just going to pray for you real quick. Okay, awesome. Just right now in this moment of privacy. Okay, awesome. Dozens of us saying, "God, we need a fresh start. Jesus, we thank you for the resurrection. Jesus, we thank you for your perfect love. Agape love, that you loved us so much that you gave everything for us. Lord, today we're receiving your grace. And we're receiving your love. Lord, I pray that your love would change every person in this room in the same way that it changed Mary and Thomas and Peter and me and countless others through the years that have experienced your resurrection power. God, for those of us that feel stuck, we just pray, God, that you would bring freedom in our lives. We love you. We thank you for the cross, and we thank you for the empty tomb. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, hey, can we give God glory for just people receiving him and making decisions for Christ? Listen, no matter where you are, if you're in overflow room or you're in this room, we're gonna take just a few more minutes. And this next few minutes is for you to respond to God. What is God saying to you, and what are you gonna do about it? Some of us are gonna go to the cross, and maybe you're stuck in some area of your life. Just write it on the cross. Pin it there. Ask God to give you freedom. Some of us have people that we love in our lives that are stuck, maybe that have locked the door on their faith, or maybe even locked the door on relationship with you. God hasn't given up on them. Don't you give up on them either. Go to the candles that are throughout the building and just light a candle. As you do that, just pray for them. God, would you bring light into their life? Many of us will take communion. You don't have to be a member of our church, but if you've given your life to Christ, we encourage you to come and take the bread and the juice to remember what Jesus did, his body, his blood that was broken for us. We have prayer teams, and some of you need the resurrection power. You know, scripture says that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is available to us today. And maybe you're stuck in a health diagnosis or you're stuck emotionally some area. Our prayer teams would be honored to pray for you. Don't delay the healing by allowing your pride to keep you from asking for help and asking for prayer. And then if you filled a card out for us, no matter what you said on it, we'd encourage you. There are baskets out by the doors. You can drop them in. And we'd love to follow up with you and help you on your spiritual journey. If you gave your life to Christ, it's a starting point today, not a finish line. The best is yet to come, the abundant life that God promises. Then we're going to worship and celebrate an awesome God. So what's God saying to you? Let's respond to him together.
On a hill in Israel, mercy spoke for me, mercy spoke for me, mercy spoke for me. It was on Golgotha's tree, his death brought liberty, his death brought liberty, his death brought liberty.
Sing this together.
May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. And may I not forget the blood he shed. It is by his death I am alive. May I never boast. because of Christ, I am alive. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I did not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the same.
What an incredible message from Pastor Josh. What an amazing time of worship. Bless you guys. Thank you so much for joining us for your Easter service. Hey, before you go, we want to just let you know a couple of great things. First of all, if you didn't get a chance already, make sure you take the time to fill out that survey because we want to hear from you.
Yes.
Whatever your situation might be. You know that, again, Pastor Josh also mentioned the series is coming up later this year where we want to be able to answer your questions about what the Bible has to say on different things. So make sure you fill that out. You can text survey to 320-320 and the link will come back to you. So check that out. And then next week we're kicking off a cool series too.
We are. We're kicking off a new series next week called Group Therapy. So this one's kind of near and dear to my heart. But our pastors are going to be tackling some of those topics that we all wonder about, like what do I do if I feel anxious? Or what does the Bible say about boundaries in relationships?
Yes,
or
so good.
Just some of those difficult things that we all have to deal with. Our pastors are going to kind of tackle, what does the Bible have to say about that?
Yeah.
How can we do that better in community and not trying to do it all on our own?
Yeah.
So it's going to be a great series. You don't want to miss it.
Absolutely. So make sure you join us again next Sunday as we kick off that series. And also, in between now and then, middle of the week, sometimes you need to pick me up. If the worship this morning blessed you, join us this Wednesday evening, 6:30 p.m. Eastern time, for First Wednesday, an extended period of worship. We would love to just... To welcome you to that service and all worship together. So,
yes, it is always a blessing.
Amen, amen. So many of you guys also give so generously to Seacoast and enable us to continue making a difference around the world. So we want to thank you again for your generosity. If you would like to contribute to the ministries of Seacoast Church, you can do so by going to seacoast.org/give or clicking give right there in that mobile app.
Yes.
So, hey, again, what a blessed time together.
Absolutely.
Take a moment and text a friend. Invite them to check us out. We've got several more service times.
That's
you can see the schedule tab on our Church Online platform. We'll show you. But don't miss the chance to share this message with someone. Let's be dismissed now with God's blessing from Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. God bless you guys. Happy Easter.